This is episode 12 of the Paperback Warrior podcast.
The Warrior has returned. And we're not talking about the Ultimate Warrior. We're not talking about the Golden State Warriors. We're talking about the Paperback Warrior podcast. And I'm your co-host, Eric. We've got some really cool stuff to talk about today. I'm going to bring on my co-host, Tom, who just walked in. What do you have on tap for today?
Well, before we get into the content of the show, I want to talk to you about an issue that we are dealing with here at Paperback Warrior, and that is the sound quality of the show. We're very happy with everything about the show. We like the Siskel and Ebert vibe we got going on. We're getting good feedback from you. I think you're enjoying the content because you keep coming back and you say nice things to us, and we appreciate that. And I maintain that you deserve a better sounding podcast than we're able to produce right now with the primitive materials that we're working with. We've got a price in mind for a sound mixer and some decent microphones that we'd like to buy for the podcast, but it's just too much money coming out of our own pockets, and we both have kids and mouths to feed. So I guess we're doing a pledge drive right now, asking that if you have it in your heart to support us financially with a pledge or a donation to Paperback Warrior so we can get some decent sound equipment and give you a better sounding podcast, we'd appreciate it. If you can't afford it, we're just happy to have you listening. Don't worry about it. Forget I said anything. However, if you have money and you can make a donation of any size, you can direct that to paperbackwarrior@yahoo.com using PayPal, and we're going to throw up a donation link on the paperbackwarrior.com blog. And thank you for this. I hate having to panhandle for money with you guys because you've been so good to us, and this is a real labor of love for us, and we just want to make it sound as good as possible.
We promise it will not be a Jimmy Swaggart thing where we spend the money on tramps.
There's zero. We're not even going to spend the money on books. We're going to spend it on equipment, so put it right back into the podcast. Anyway, enough panhandling. We got an episode to do. And
You're the one that's next here. You're talking about your Georgia trip.
Yes, this is a good point. So I'm going to talk about my trip to Georgia. We are going to discuss the odd life of Milton Ozaki, and we're going to review a book called Sergeant Hawk and review an Ozaki book as well. So I recently took a trip, a book shopping trip. Well, actually, it was a business trip up to Macon, Georgia from northern Florida, up I-75. I-75 goes north and south from Florida up through the Midwest. But as soon as you leave Florida, you find yourself in Georgia. And so when you get north of Valdosta, Georgia, the next big town is Macon, Georgia. And there's a series of four bookstores there that go up north from Byron, Georgia, to Warner Robins, Georgia, into Macon, Georgia. The name of the bookstore chain is Gottwalls Books, Gottwalls Books. And I stopped at every one of the four stores on my trip, and I wanted to tell you about this bookstore in case you ever happen to be in the area. It was very well organized. The one thing I didn't like about it, and they did this annoying thing that I find a lot, where they mix in the mystery and action novels with the general fiction. So you have to wade through the Danielle Steele books to get to the good stuff, but there is lots of good stuff. And so I ended up photographing a lot of the books and finds there like I was some kind of bird watcher. And some of the highlights of what I found was they had a giant selection of Easy Company books, which is an adult Western series starring an army cavalry soldiers with an ensemble cast, written under the house name of John Wesley Howard. I really enjoyed that series, and I was happy to see that they're available there. The Violent UK Westerns, written by the pseudonym George Gilman, the Edge books, they had a bunch of those there. They had just tons and tons of Nick Carter Killmasters. They had Destroyer, Able Team, Mac Bolan, Phoenix Force, those weird sort of like sexy, I've never read them, the Gore books, G-O-R, by John Norman. They had those there. They had Barry Sadler's Casca series there, which are pretty hard to find in used bookstores. They had the Renegade series by Ramsey Thorne, which is a pseudonym of Lou Cameron that we talked about a few weeks ago. They had Eric Helms' Vietnam Ground Zero series, the SOB books. They had a ton of those Alfred Hitchcock short story anthologies, which I just love those. Those are always such a great value. John D. MacDonald, a lot of his standalone books. Alistair MacLean, They had Man from U.N.C.L.E. books there, Peter McCurtain books. They had a complete set of the Rat Bastard books by Len Levinson, his World War II series written under the pseudonym of John Mackey. They had this post-apocalyptic series I liked in the 80s by the name Richard Austin, the Guardians series. They had a bunch of Death Merchants. I mentioned Able Team and Phoenix Force. The prices were right, too, at Gottwald's books. All the used books in these categories were either $1.97 or $2.97. They had a separate section for science fiction that I didn't really go through because it's not really my thing. But they had amazing Western sections at each one of these bookstores as well that were segregated. In the Western section, they had tons of standalone authors and kind of traditional old Westerns, as well as the Johnstones that you would expect, and lots of the adult Westerns. I remember seeing a giant row of Gunsmith books there, a series I've enjoyed by Robert Randese. The only book I ended up purchasing there, because I had a lot of these books and a lot of these series, was actually misfiled in the Western section at the Macon, Georgia store. It was Driscoll's Diamonds by Ian McAllister. Now, Ian McAllister was a pseudonym clearly developed to try to capitalize on Ian Fleming of the James Bond series and Alistair MacLean. But Ian McAllister was actually a pseudonym of Marvin Albert, who was a great novelist of the 50s, 60s, 70s, and 80s. And he wrote four standalone books, kind of high adventure novels, under the name of Ian McAllister. And I'm told that Driscoll's Diamonds is actually the best of the four. They came out in Fawcett Gold Medal. Even though it's not a Western, they had it misfiled because the cover sort of looks like a Western. Anyway, that's it. I just want to turn you guys on to that in case you find yourself on I-75 between the Florida state line and Macon, Georgia. It's definitely worth your time to stop by Gottwald's Books.
So our listeners who like gritty crime drama, crime action-adventure sort of books might appreciate the Macon County Line. Tom just brought up Macon and made me think of this. It's a 1974 crime drama where a small-town sheriff has his wife brutally murdered by two drifters, one of which I think was played by the guy who played Jethro on Beverly Hillbillies. But it's a great movie, Macon County Line. They made a sequel called Return to Macon County. Or Return to Macon County Line, but it came out in 1974, 1 year after the Walking Tall movie made small-town vigilante justice a household thing. Everybody wanted to make those kind of movies and sort of exploit the Walking Tall thing. So Macon County Line.
I wonder if there was a movie tie-in book for Macon County Line. That would have been interesting.
Yeah, I'm not sure. I was looking it up, and I couldn't find where it was based on a novel or if there was a novel written about it, but it would have made a good one. I think there was maybe a short-lived TV show where that sheriff was hunting down other criminals, but I may be thinking of Walking Tall turning into a show. I'm not sure, but...
Do you remember if the movie, was it a theatrical release or one of those made-for-TV movies they did back then?
Macon County Line was a theatrical release, and I think it made pretty good money.
If they had sequels and a spin-off TV show, it must have been quite a hit.
Yeah, they used to show it all the time on TBS back in the 90s, 80s and 90s. It was always on TV, but...
Well, my brief time in Macon found absolutely no vigilante justice going on, but it was a nice enough town.
All right, good, good. I'm glad you made it through there.
Well, good. Let's make it to... let's talk about our feature today. Our feature is going to be kind of peeling back the onion on an author who has a really interesting backstory by the name of Milton Ozaki. He was born in Kenosha, Wisconsin, a little bit north of Chicago, to a Japanese-American family. He was a crime fiction author who wrote mass-market paperbacks under his own name, as well as the pseudonym of Robert O. Saber in the 1950s. Somewhere along the line, either while he was writing or after he got done writing, he also opened up two beauty shops in Chicago. It's not unusual for people to write in pseudonyms back then. It was just kind of the economic reality of publishing in the 1950s. Basically, these authors employed pseudonyms to make a living. Handy Books, which is one of his main publishers, probably just didn't want to flood the market with books by Ozaki. So about half the novels he wrote were published under this Robert O. Saber pen name. And there's no harm to that. Everybody wins. It was a little odd because they were often republished like a year later under Milton Ozaki's real name. So he published about 27 different novels under his two pseudonyms, and plus his women's hairstyling career. Evidently, this failed to give Ozaki the lifetime of financial security that he really desired. So he decided to channel his energies elsewhere. And so life began to imitate art with this guy who is the author of many heist and con man stories, basically turns his fiction into a dark reality. What he did was he took on a life of con man games himself, And I want to tell you some of the scams that he started running. In the 1970s, Ozaki began operating what we call a diploma mill, which is a mail-order scam involving the issuance of phony college degrees from non-existent universities, including Colorado State Christian College and Hamilton State University. So if you donated $100 to either of those universities, you could walk away with a college degree. Now, I have to figure that campus life at these universities must have been pretty mundane since they were nothing but post office boxes in Colorado. And so if you go to a doctor for brain surgery or a vasectomy who went to either of these schools, you may just want to go elsewhere for your medical procedure. Anyway, so Ozaki made about $70,000 from that scam until the courts ordered him to knock it off in 1974. And there was an article written about him by Mike Royko, a famous Chicago journalist in a now-defunct newspaper called the Chicago Daily News. In 1974 was a doubly bad year for Ozaki because he was also sued by the Colorado Attorney General's office for another con game that he operated. He was the director of a company called KO-ZEE Products Corporation. He sold a phony mini turbocharger guaranteed to give your car 37% better gas mileage. Now, the device did not work, but the government's action did. And so this former crime writer who turned scammer was basically put out of business again. But he kept going after that. He ran a mail order school teaching paying students how to develop their powers of ESP and hypnosis, skill sets that he clearly didn't have or he would have seen the government investigations coming. In a newspaper article by Royko, Ozaki was quoted as saying, involving his multitude of failures as a professional grifter, he said, quote, "We are trying to do good work, and we just ran afoul of these archaic-minded bureaucrats," which sounds like a reworking of the Scooby-Doo lament, you know, and it would have worked if it weren't for you meddling kids. So Ozaki dies in Kenosha, Wisconsin in 1989 at the age of 76, but many of his mystery books, which are by and large pretty excellent, and we're going to talk about one later, are still available as ebooks and paperback reprints today. And although I spent the last 5 minutes disparaging this guy about the bad decisions he made in his life, I actually really enjoy his books. And I'm going to review The Case of the Cop's Wife coming up later in the show. But first, you have a book review you wanted to give us, or you have something else to talk about.
Yeah, I wanted to add something to your Ozaki story. And this is pretty interesting. Some of the things you were saying about his life and going from being a potentially lucrative author to being sort of destitute and doing some illegal things, it mirrors the things that happened with author Jay Flynn, who you may remember penned the McHugh series.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's kind of like a spy
series. He also wrote a book called The Action Man.
Yeah, he did Action Man.
Terror Tournament was another Terror one Tournament. Of his ace doubles, yeah.
Yeah, in fact, Action Man and Terror Tournament were both released as a Starkhouse crime classic. I guess Starkhouse Press reprinted those two books as one. But it has this really cool intro by Bill Pronzini where he talks about Jay Flynn's life. Get these for comparisons. He goes from writing these great books. He was signed to Ace, and he was writing for Avon at the time. But then he gets into to drinking really bad. He goes destitute, poor. He starts writing porno books. He eventually ends up moving to Virginia, and he gets involved with bootlegging. And he runs a nip shop in the back of a barber shop with these bootleggers. He ends up on Skid Row. He thinks some demons are after him, so he pulls out a revolver, shoots the ceiling out, which then ends up dumping a bunch of water on him. He breaks his leg, ends up in the hospital, and eventually, combination of alcohol and just poor health, he ends up dying. We need to do a feature on Jay Flynn.
Yeah, sounds like it.
He's a really good writer. I've read his McHugh books, and they're really good.
It's remarkable to me how little these authors were making. I mean, Ozaki wrote nearly 30 novels, and which are still in print today and are very collectible. You end up spending a good bit of money for them. Yet he's probably only making $1,000 or $2,000 per book over the course of a writing career. And I don't know, I guess we take a look at these authors and we think that because we love their work so much and how enduring their work has been, that they must have been making a small fortune. But I just think that's probably not the case. You take a look at Harry Whittington, who ended up going to work for the Department of Agriculture to make ends meet. you know, or even the death merchant guy, Rosenberger, wasn't making any money doing that, his books, based on an article I read in Glorious Trash. So it's just, it's fascinating to me how, I guess he just had to sell a heck of a lot of books at 25 cents or 35 cents to make a living, and it just wasn't happening for most of these guys. Yet we look at them and remember them so fondly today. I guess I never really put it together. I was just sort of assumed that if you're a famous author from the 1950s, there was some like NFL league minimum that you were paid, but that's clearly not the case, or Ozaki wouldn't have taken the path he did, or Flynn wouldn't have been destitute in his life.
And you mentioned earlier about the Alfred Hitchcock magazines that you saw in the stores in Georgia. What were they paying these authors?
Well, I have no idea. I can't imagine that the digests were paying much. I think in the introduction to the Manhunt magazine, they may have talked about how much they were paying those authors, but hell, if they were only paying $1,000 or $2,000 for an entire novel, I can't imagine that they were paying more than $100 or $200 for a short story.
Yeah, in Pranzini's piece, he mentions that Flynn was writing the sex books for $1,200 a title, which was top notch, top shelf price.
Yeah, and $1,200. Hell, they were probably moving a lot of units too, so to speak.
No pun intended.
All right. Wow. Moving on.
Yeah. So I'm a sucker for a really good World War II story. I'm the resident military fiction guy here at Paperback Warrior. So I spotted a book called Sergeant Hawk on Tom's shelf a few weeks back and decided to give it a whirl because he probably was never going to read it. It's written by Patrick Clay, and I have no earthly idea who Patrick Clay is. But in my research, I found out that this book is the first of a series of books. There's 4 total installments. And oddly, none of them really share any kind of uniformity. The fonts are all different on each book. The first 2 books in the series aren't even numbered. Here's the volumes of the series. Number 1, Sergeant Hawk, 1979. Number 2, The Return of Sergeant Hawk, 1980. Number 3, Under Attack, 1981. Number 4, Tiger Island, 1982. This debut novel, just Sergeant Hawk, and the whole series is set in the South Pacific during World War II. And, of course, the enemy is the Japanese. So the novel introduces us to Hawk as this gruff, battle-hardened Marine sergeant. He's got this really thick Southern accent because he's from Mississippi. He doesn't have a wife or kids or anything that sort of ties him back to any kind of civilian life. He's just made for fighting. The book's set on this unknown island where U.S. forces are battling the Japanese. In early action, we see Hawk lead his platoon against this heavily armed pillbox, and he takes most of the risk upon himself to avoid any harm to his platoon. But after this exciting action, the orders are given for Hawk and his platoon to go and protect this rubber plantation that's being owned and ran by a Dutch family. The idea is that the U.S. forces are going to assault the eastern side of the island and try to annihilate the Japanese forces. Intelligence reports predict that the Japanese will retreat and head northwest to this portion of the island where the rubber plantation is. So they want Hawk to lead 15 Marines across the island, which is going to take about 2 days, and there they're going to camp out at this plantation. The goal is to stop the retreating Japanese, but also protect the plantation and the Van Speers, which own it. I guess the journey there really isn't really described too much in the book. There's a couple pages dedicated to it, but Hawk and company eventually meet Mr. Van Speer on the property and his wife, and they really don't want them there. They really don't understand the global impact of the war. They just they feel like their lives really aren't in danger. But Hawk convinces them that, you know, hey, the war's come to the island, the Japanese are around the corner, and we're going to protect you. We're going to camp out for a couple weeks. We're going to wait for signs of the Japanese. It's really a cushion job for his men, but excuse me, things get really crazy. So it's sort of this wild murder mystery, like an Agatha Christie's 10 Little Indians or something. Hawk's men are found murdered one by one each night on the property. So some are in foxholes, some are in barns, but they're stabbed to death. And it seems like an impossible feat because the men are there watching 24/7 for the Japanese to come through the jungle. So it's really odd that the men are being killed. especially considering that they just fought back to back, shoulder to shoulder through Japanese forces already. Why would they be killing their own people? But Hawk develops this love interest with the oldest daughter of the Van Speer family. Her name is Gretchen, and I think this adds a little bit more depth to the story and sort of makes Hawk seem human after we see him being this early killing machine. The author does a really good job of building this suspenseful killer mystery. It's a seaside plantation. It's always foggy. There's a sense of isolation because they're really the only ones in the area. It just works really, really well. But, you know, this is a war novel, and man, does it get violent in a hurry. Without ruining it for you, I don't want to do that, but, you know, let's just say the last chapters are just one epic battle, and it's very, very violent. There's also the big reveal on who the killer or killers are, and I had a theory that didn't really pan out at all on what was actually happening on the island, but I was pleasantly surprised when the reveal occurs. But man, this thing is violent. They're fighting in the jungle, they're fighting on the farm, they're fighting in the house. It was really enjoyable. I loved this book. I went ahead and ordered the other three books in the series. I found a decent deal on the fourth novel, which normally goes for about $20. Just depending on which online retailer you use, you should be able to get them for $5 to $20. Tom, I loved this book. Again, it's Sergeant Hawk by Patrick Clay, and definitely look for this one. It's great.
I'm really looking forward to your review of the second and onward, the four books in that series, to see if this guy can actually keep up that pace. And it's just odd that this is another author who came out of nowhere. We know nothing about him. He writes four books and then disappears into thin air. It just seems that happened so much back then when folks were writing these original paperbacks.
Yeah, I can't make heads or tails of it, but I'm really excited to read those books.
Good. Well, shifting gears, I'm going to talk about a book by Milton Ozaki, the grifter we discussed earlier, and try to redeem his good name to you. The book I want to review is called Case of the Cop's Wife. The majority of his books were private eye stories, but he wrote a handful of well-regarded standalone novels, including this 1958 Fawcett Gold Medal book. When the book opens, we meet Chicago Police Lieutenant Robert Fury, who's preparing to take some vacation coinciding with the upcoming birth of his first child. Now, his pregnant wife is a woman by the name of Mary Ellen, who's also the daughter of a famous wealthy businessman in Chicago. So the scene then cuts to a heist crew who's planning an elaborate plan to knock over a large department store at opening on payday when the armored truck is arriving with the cash to pay the employees. Now, the heist crew is really cool. There's these, like, malevolent thugs, and they threw in a hot babe getaway driver who gets super horny when whipped with a belt, and which is very typical in kind of 1950s fiction. There's nothing graphic going on here, but the idea of somebody like that was very alluring to the mostly male readership, and probably still is to this very day. Anyway, so Mary Ellen is this cop's wife, just this beautiful, highly pregnant woman. She shows up to the department store at opening time, and she walks into a total bloodbath. One thing leads to another, and Mary Ellen, this pregnant wife of a Chicago police lieutenant, is snatched away by the robbers and taken hostage. So the action then shifts in Ozaki's writing from character to character, with the core being Mary Ellen and the heist crew, but when they cut to the police, who are working extra hard to catch these bad guys because of Mary Ellen's connection with Lieutenant Fury, it's this fantastic police procedural. This book was so exciting. Ozaki kept the story moving. It had very short scenes that cut from one third-person point of view to another, a literary technique that I really love when Stephen King used to do that. I was just left with the impression of this book that Ozaki was just a way better writer than many of his contemporaries writing for Fawcett Gold Medal in that era. But he's never remembered for the quality of his plotting, but this was a nearly perfect action crime novel. I'm told that his standalone crime novels are superior to his series books. I read a standalone book by him and reviewed it on the site called Inquest. That was very good, but nowhere near as good as Case of the Cop's Wife. If this is a fair representation of his talent, I really want to delve deeper into his books. I mean, this was a crime, suspense, heist, police procedural novel that if you're a fan of any of those genres, you're going to love it too. It's without a doubt one of the most compelling books I read this year, and I can't recommend it highly enough. You don't necessarily have to go out and spend a fortune on the paperback if you're an ebook kind of guy. Prologue Crime has this book is for, I think, $2.99 as an ebook, and it's actually free if you subscribe to Kindle Unlimited, which is this amazing value for folks like me who like my paperbacks digitally sometimes. Anyway, so that's Case of the Cop's Wife by Milton Ozaki, a terrific novel, and I encourage all of you to check that out.
Yeah, and if you have a favorite title that you like from this author, or you have a tidbit about the author's life, definitely share it with us. paperbackwarrior@yahoo.com. Tom wrote a Paperback Warrior Unmasking on Milton Ozaki. If you go to our paperbackwarrior.com site, go to the right-hand side, scroll down in alphabetical order, and click on Milton Ozaki. You'll find his archived review of Case of the Cop's Wife and the Unmasking column as well. Really cool books shown here in this column. City of Sin, Murder Honeymoon, No Way Out, The Frigid Blonde. There's also a link in here to purchase Milton Ozaki books. So definitely utilize that if you have any plan to buy any of those books. But that brings us to the end of another exciting half hour of fun, or close to a half hour anyway. Next week, we're going to discuss two more books, and of course, we'll have a feature for you as well. But next week, we're also going to look back at the month of September. We're going to talk about some of our favorite September reads. Again, paperbackwarrior.com is a home of a slew of reviews. We post new ones each weekday morning at 6 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. And, of course, you'll find our new show episodes every single Monday. But that's all I have. You have anything else, Tom?
No, I mean, you know, every word that comes out of our mouth is pure poetry, and I just hope that it can sound better with a better sound system. So to the extent that you're able to support us, please help out.
Sounds good. Thanks so much. Bye-bye now.